So, hello everybody. My name is Judith Schaeffer. I'm working for Continental in Ringsburg in the pre-development department artificial intelligence and robotics. And this is Andreas Graf from ET Misaki. And today we will introduce you our approach for an integrated development environment built on Eclipse for automotive machine learning. First of all, what does artificial intelligence or deep learning in the automotive domain mean? So the most obvious is probably automated driving. This includes, for example, that the car must detect persons and also other cars and so on. But it's not only about recognizing the objects, it's important that the car really understands the whole scenario. So, for example, when we have a look at this first small video, this video you can see, okay, that the walkway is detected and there's a person. The man is standing, everything is fine, we can just pass. In the second video, we can see almost a similar scenario with the same man walking outside. So the car detects, okay, the man is going outside, maybe he wants to cross the street, but yeah, there's no danger, we have to take attention, but we don't have to reduce the speed. And the third video, again, similar scenario, but now the same person is coming out with a red backpack. This might be an indicator for that fact that a child must, or maybe also come out this entry. This is a use case where we have to take attention because the behavior of a child is not that predictable than of an adult. And that's why, in the first video, the car must understand this and maybe also reduce the speed a little bit and take attention. And yeah, now we can see the child is well behaving, but if not, we would have made that. It's not only automated driving. There are also other use cases. So when you think about the comfort, maybe I think most of you already got into that, where did I leave the car keys? And with artificial intelligence, you can cope with this problem. For example, when enabling the authentication by iris recognition or face recognition of the owner of the car. And also, maybe a little bit more for comfort. For example, the emotion could be detected when you enter the car, and based on your emotion, the appropriate music is already played or something like that. Thinking about the reliability, there are also some use cases which are not directly related with automated driving, but are very important and could be improved by the use of deep learning. For example, the prediction of the battery lifetime for an e-mobility vehicle, or also the prediction of the exchange of other parts of the car so that they are exchanged right before they are broken, also to avoid the breakdown of a car. And last but not least, to bring all this somehow together, one goal is to have a seamless transportation. This means that when I'm trying to get from point A to point B, everything together, so everything is seamless. For example, when I go out of the underground and I would like to go to destination B and I'm lazy maybe, I also have the opportunity to enter to another transportation system, or also considering the delivery so that you don't have these breaks between the different transportation and the inter and intra-city. So we can have a short look at this video, which is a new mobility concept, which has been also developed by one of our pre-development department, which is called the B, and yeah, it somehow includes all these deep learning applications because it's automated driving and also has this comfort functions, let's say. Okay, just going shortly into this, and I'm not sure whether it's already done, but no worries. just do it again. A short overview. Okay, these are a few use cases about the use of artificial intelligence in the automotive domain. And yeah, now going to the development of artificial intelligence or deep learning. So deep learning is a complete new paradigm of software development, because instead of learning by rules, you learn by example. This means so you have a training phase in which you define a model architecture, and you need a huge set of example. For example, here, if you would like to predict whether the object you're facing is a truck or car, you need a huge amount of images of a car, of cars and trucks. And in this training phase, the model learns by itself how it does or how it makes its decisions in future, and defines its weights for these decisions on its own. And then in the execution phase, so this is basically the application then, it's able, or at least it should be able, to predict here whether this image is or whether this camera or this object is a car or a truck. Yeah, giving a short summary of this development process. So as I already said, you always have this input data, which have to be pre-processed. This means so you have to collect them, you have to prepare them, because often the data you get are not suitable for learning, or they don't have that quality. In general, this part of pre-processing data takes around 70% of the work of an AI developer, so this is a lot. And it's a huge effort. And with the processed data set, you can start your training. So you define a model architecture and you train the model, which also takes generally a long time. And with a trained model, you can then build an application, which means, for example, a face recognition application, which can decide who you are or something like this. And on the automotive domain, you mostly want to put this application then on an embedded controller. And this already leads me to one of our challenges, which is the computing power. So for both the development, but also for the execution, you need much more computing power than for traditional software components, let's say. For example, when training neural networks, I cannot just use my normal laptop. I need a high-performance computer to do this, and therefore I also somehow need the access to these machines. And also considering the vehicles themselves, we have to think about new chip architectures, and also maybe to extend the vehicle network in order to ensure that the performance can be reached. Another challenge is safety. So some of you might know the ISO 26262, which is the standard for functional safety in the automotive domain, but this doesn't handle artificial intelligence at all in the moment. And yeah, we need to find new validation methods, because of course we must ensure that the model doesn't predict anything wrong, and we also must to understand why this neural network takes its decisions. Why maybe it takes wrong, and we have to ensure that it never go wrong, of course, when we try to embed it in the vehicle. And in the last challenge, which I would like to introduce, is the effective development. So as artificial intelligence is relatively new in the automotive domain, we don't have any defined workflows yet for the development, and not any defined tools for that. That's why we are trying to find a solution to support the developer in his development, and also to improve the workflows and the access to all the tools in order to make the software development easier, and therefore also to minimize the time to market and to enable better reuse, because if everyone uses the same tools and the same methodology, you can easier hand it over to another department. Okay, that's from my side with the challenges and approach to improve this effective development is our integrated development DAISY, which means development environment for artificial intelligence systems. And yeah, this will now be introduced further by Andreas.
Okay, thank you, Judith. So to give you an idea, Judith just said that there is no or little standardization about the development of such neural networks. I'll give you an idea about the roles and tools that we have. So in the top row, we might have deep learning engineers. These are the guys and girls that are defining the neural networks, doing the research work, etc. And I'll like to introduce the typical toolchain that they use. So several of you, or mostly all of you, know Python, and Python is has established itself as the de facto scripting language in the data science domain. So anybody who develops a neural network will probably use Python for that. And there are a lot of Python-based frameworks that you can use. We see here the TensorFlow logo, but there's also Keras, Caffe, etc. So this type of role will usually use Python, and as Judith just said, you cannot train these things anymore on a PC. So what companies in the automotive domain actually do, they will put up their own cloud or use the cloud services of something like Amazon Web Services, because they provide virtual machines on demand that give you a strong GPU. So in neural networks, you will use graphics processing engines, units like that you have in your graphic cards, and you will use the high-end versions, which are really expensive, and you can just buy these machines, these configurations in the cloud. So that's where you're actually going to train your neural network. So as Judith showed, the images with the car and the truck will be trained on something like Amazon Web Services. And then you will be actually prototyping something on a development board that will enable you to mirror the hardware that you will have in the car. And one of the strong players is NVIDIA here. And in our setup, we are using NVIDIA boards. And as you can see from the logo, they are usually running a Linux operating system, in this case Ubuntu. Just because we're in the EclipseCon, also one of the exhibitors here, Renesas, provides something similar. So this could also be a Renesas board, but you will have a development board here. And as you see, okay, so now Python, Amazon Web Services, these are not really embedded technologies, so you will have one guy or one team who actually gets tons of neural networks defined by the departments, usually in different versions from Python, different Python versions, some with TensorFlow, some with Keras, who is actually responsible for integrating all of that on a car computer, an ECU, embedded control unit. And these kind of tools, he will probably try to actually put this logic that they generated and the frameworks in C or C++, mostly C++ nowadays, and also containerization technologies like Docker, are actually playing a stronger role even on the embedded systems. So we are going in terms of containerization on the platform as well. And then they will have a similar setup for the embedded systems. And one important thing is, which I put here, RRM. They will have different processors than your usual notebook. So you will have an x86 processor in your notebook, but the machine in the training machine and the car will usually have a different processor, what means that you have to compile it totally differently. You cannot use the binaries that you generate on your developer PC to actually run the stuff. So when we started out, like end of last year, to see how we can actually support that zoo of tools, we looked at Eclipse, we looked at Eclipse J, and if you look at Eclipse for all of these tools, you actually find a project in Eclipse. So that's very nice. You have already structure infrastructure for all of that. You have a Python development environment with PyDev. You have a nice integration for Amazon Web Services. There's an Amazon client for that. With the Remote Systems Explorer, you can actually go down on your embedded machines with different connections. Obviously, there's CDT, and we have a nice, or we have a basic Docker support. In tools, you can have a graphical view on your Docker configurations, and again, going down to the system, actually. So as you could think, it's all just assembling a lot of plugins, and then you have a really nice IDE, and we started out with that. And actually what we're doing is we are setting up a prototype to check all the stuff. And this is actually a configuration that the colleague from Judith has on his desk and which we reproduced. So what we do is we have the DAISY development environment. And then we have actually a set of Raspberry PIs. One of them has a webcam, and they are connected over the network to actually NVIDIA developer board where the neural networks run. So you can actually make a real car setup on your desk. And obviously, the Raspberry PI is very cheap. Every one of you can actually reproduce it. And for the NVIDIA board, automotive companies actually use the modern versions, which cost a few thousand, but NVIDIA also sells an older board called the Jetson, which is a few hundreds, which you can actually put on your desk and then have a real realistic automotive setup. And we have different use cases where we validated how it actually feels to work with Eclipse to set up systems like that. And yeah, we actually started to assemble the stuff. So what do we have? We actually assembled all the plugins like PyDev, AWS, RSE, CDT, the Linux tools, and we have a TensorFlow integration. But it's not so nice if you just assemble the plugins, all of them, because what you get when you start the Eclipse IDE is you get a really cluttered IDE. You have a lot of buttons, you have a lot of menus. Some of the plugins behave badly. In the beginning, we also had, I think it was the Asia plugin from Microsoft that put a menu everywhere. No matter what, you had it on files, you had it on everywhere, was Asia. You don't want that. So actually, we put in a lot of effort to define perspectives. And also, that was quite an effort to get rid of all the menus that you don't want to see. But that's actually something that you have to do for the acceptance. So, and I'll show a few of these details, what we did in the few slides. We improved the PyDev support. We improved Linux tools and Dockers. And we did an integration for TensorFlow. So first start, if you use PyDev, PyDev is the Python environment, and you can actually have more than one environment of Python, what libraries are provided on your machine through a framework that is called Conda or Anaconda. But the problem is that PyDev doesn't support that out of the box. So if you want to use that framework, you actually have to configure the interpreters manually, and we added stuff on that so that it finds all the Python environments that you have created with Conda automatically, and it also assigns it correctly to the products. And then, as we said, we want a minimal, or we don't want the user to have to choose between tools, etc. We also created additional menu points that allow the user to start the correct Python environment for the project that he's currently in with the correct settings, etc. And also we have additional support for the Conda environment directly in the IDE. So if a project, if you check out of a project, there will be an environment text file in there that tells the Conda installation what actually which packages it has to install, and usually have to go to command line and install, invoke that. And we just created update menus so that it's more seamless. Then the next thing is, if you develop with TensorFlow, so the neural network, there's a tooling called TensorBoard that is actually giving you displays about the data that you've created, statistics, etc. And usually you would have to go to command line again, start a server, blah, 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 find your files, etc. And also we created an integration for TensorBoard so that you just have to click on your project where you're working and it will find the relevant log files that and data files that are interesting for TensorBoard and it will create a server and it will start the TensorBoard IDE within Eclipse so you don't have to choose between tools. And one of the major changes that we did is to the Linux tools Docker support. So when we started out, we had just one Docker container, but as you can see, we had a configuration with three Raspberry PIs, an NVIDIA machine, and they all run a Docker swarm. And so you can, for those not familiar with Docker, a Docker swarm is a set of containers that actually can be used to communicate together and set up a network between those. And what we actually did, what you can see in the screenshot in above, you now have, we have created a Docker swarm support. So for a swarm, you can see all servers, all containers, etc. in the swarm. And also what we are creating is when the user modifies the source code, we are creating the configuration files for Docker automatically, like Docker Compose, etc. And we built upon the Linux tools so that the user can now just drag and drop or use a mouse a menu to actually deploy that the software, and he doesn't have to go to the machine, etc. What he does, he is actually just dragging one file to the Docker swarm, and everything is automatically redeployed on the corresponding systems. So that's one of the changes that we hope that we also can get back to the Linux tool project. So we're currently in discussion with that. So so for the conclusion is, so in the beginning, as I said, we started out like December of last year, something like that. And we also had a look at that time at Eclipse J to see if that would be a feasible option. But at that time, the Eclipse J from its architecture was not extensible enough or easily extensible. And a lot of the functionality, like a really good C development environment, Python, AVS support, was missing basically. So the discussion was, decision was easily made for an Eclipse RCP-based development environment. And so if you in your company want to assemble such an IDE for your purposes, you have to put in some effort to get rid of all the menus and buttons that you don't want. That's something that you need to do. But we found out then, if you have something like that, as you see with the additional menus, you can actually support a really smooth workflow where you don't have a lot of tool breaks anymore. Just by integrating another tool, calling a script, etc., it's not that much effort. But it makes life much easier for developers. And also, obviously, one of the benefits is that we are integrating on the Eclipse platform. So the next step is to integrate already existing tools that the projects already have. For example, for architecture definition, interface definition, languages, smart contracts, etc. So, if you're going to play with machine learning, Python, TensorFlow, don't just stick to Jupyter Notebook or something like that. We're at the EclipseCon. You can actually build a very nice environment for machine learning with the Eclipse framework. And we are going to further work on the DAISY environment and see what comes of that so that we take Eclipse to the next type of machine learning. So that's from our side. So now we will be open about for questions about the machine learning and Eclipse approach. So some of the things basically are continental internal, but we can probably check in because we did as ETEMIS, we did the Linux tool integration. We can actually provide, for example, the Linux tool stuff. That's something that we need to discuss.
So generally, also the whole environment, so we're open to for discussions to make this open source, but yeah, as a prerequisite, we will need a community. So if you know that there is a community outside, we could definitely start this step, because in a big company it's always a little bit complicated to reach this, but it's definitely feasible, and we already did this for other projects, and we are definitely open for making such an IDE open source if there's the interest in the community outside. Yes, true. So it's also true that it's not very specific, because also in our company we have a lot of different use cases, and we didn't want to focus on just one department. That's also why you're, for example, flexible in using either TensorFlow, Caffe, whatever framework. Yeah. So it depends. So for our part, we're in the pre-development. That's why there are not that many people in the pipeline at the moment. So you mostly have one who does this training, and one other guy from another department who builds this application. For that, we, for example, build these different perspectives. So that, for example, the guy who implements the application and deploys it only sees the Docker tooling and not the person who's training the neural network, who then sees, for example, the AWS connection and the remote systems view and so on. But yeah, it depends on the complexity of the project. So in series, you have, of course, a lot of more people involved. But yeah, for the first use case, we focus rather on this rapid prototyping, so on the pre-development.
Yeah. So in this use case, it was actually quite easy because the components that we use don't have any singleton plugins that are actually much conflicting. So you can install Linux tools in basically any environment. The AVS tooling is quite benign. So we also had the nice situation that we could start from a greenfield, so we could just take Oxygen or now Photon and just install everything. But it's correct. So for example, when we start integrating stuff, so for example, we have some projects that might use different versions of Xtext right now if you're going into the architecture tooling, which are often implemented with DSLs like Xtext. Then you have an integration issue, for example, if one tool uses Xtext 2.9, 2.10, etc. And in some cases, we just have to eat the bitter fruit and then update the older projects to a newer Xtext version. But that's mainly the issue. But there was not much of an issue for that here. There were no real conflicts. Yeah. So, any further questions?
Not yet. So, as Andrea said, we started at the end of last year, but in the next year we have several research projects together with other companies and also internal to define standards for that, and there are also already evaluations ongoing, for example, for the evaluation of neural networks and so on, and it's planned to implement our own plugins and integrate them in DAISY then, but not yet. Yeah.
Okay. So if there are no further questions, I suggest if you're interested in this, talk to Conti.
Yes, sure.
And then thanks for the questions and the interest, and don't hesitate to come up to the both of us during the EclipseCon if you can think of further questions. Okay, thank you very much.